Up until now, every code that we have written was run based on some kind of user interaction. So the user created a content item, the user opened a controller action, something like that. But what if you want to have processes that run independently of user interactions? Now, you can use something called background tasks for this. The background tasks are a very simple to use concept, very simple to use, but very powerful concept in Orchard Core. You can create background tasks by implementing an IBackgroundTask interface, configuring things a bit, and now you have a piece of code that can run independently of a user interaction. It just needs the application to be running. And it can run every minute, every 5 minutes, every hour or something like that, which is also configurable. So you can use such background tasks to, for example, do some cleanup jobs, send out emails in bulk, do some report generation at the end of the day. You get the idea. Of course, background tasks are not really designed to run all your backend processing there for huge systems. That's not something that you'd usually do on a web server anyway. But still, if you want to run some recurring tasks in the context of an Orchard Core application, background tasks are a very nice way to do them. So let's see how to create a background task. Background tasks, well, we commonly put into a namespace and folder called services, but this is just conventional. It's up to you. If you have a lot of background tasks in a module, you can also create a background tasks namespace or something. But services is where we, put let's say code that is used by other code. So not something tightly related to user interactions and not something more specific like filters or permissions. So let's create a background task here and let's call it demo background task. Of course, we have a snippet for it, because I'm sure I don't want to type all of this in. And what the snippet generates for us is pretty complete already. So let's try to understand. Well, first you see that, of course, our background task will be a standard class, and it needs to implement the IBackgroundTask interface. But that's not enough. It also needs to tell Orchard how frequently it needs to run. Here in this background task attribute, you can do specifically that. And the schedule parameter here is actually a cron expression. If you don't know cron expressions, don't worry. You can also use something like the cron type guru service, where you can generate such expressions. It looks a bit like regular expressions. It's as alien for me than regular expressions, but it's very logical, and you can easily just generate it here without having to remember the whole syntax. What we have predefined here is something for minutes. So under this this number, you can specify how many minutes should pass between two background task executions. Just to make things fast, I will use one. And secondly, you also can specify a description for background tasks here. This description will be visible on the admin UI, which we'll also check out in a minute. But for now, let's provide some description here. Like just a background, just a demo background task. We also need to specify the class name again for a snippet, and that's it. We also need to, implement this DoWorkAsync here. Well, let me add the namespace. DoWorkAsync is where you have to do everything. And it has two parameters. Cancellation token is kind of self-explanatory. If you don't know, cancellation token is a standard .NET thing. This is a representation of of a cancellation, as the name also suggests. You can, in this cancellation token, you can check this isCancellation requested property. This means that if the outside process if the outside process cancels background tasks, like when the application is being shut down or the tenant is restarted, then in your background task you can check for this and make sure that you stop whatever you're doing as soon as possible. If you have just a simple, very short-lived, very quick background task operation here, then this doesn't really matter. If you are doing something like you are looping through thousands of items and you are doing some heavy processing, then it's advised to check this in every iteration. So when a cancellation is requested, you really quickly stop the process, you clean up the whole thing, and then you return here. So whatever happens that requested that cancellation can safely continue. But we also have a service provider here, and this iService provider is again a .NET Core thing. This is the dependency injection container where you can request registered services from. But why is this actually necessary? Can't we just inject things, dependencies in the constructor? Well, kind of. The reason why we have this, because kind of you shouldn't do it most of the time. And why is that? The reason for that is that how you need to register a background task is not as a scope service, but as a singleton. If you don't know, singletons are services that live as long as, well, as the dependency injection container lives, and in this case that means that as long as the tenant's shell lives. So pretty much as long as the tenant is running and it's not restarted with a configuration change or when you turn a feature on or off. So these are long-lived services, and that means that they can't just directly use services that should be short-lived, scoped, or even transient. Well, they can use, they shouldn't, because it can cause all kinds of funny behavior. So we have to register our background task as a singleton here. And we have to register it, of course, as a background IBackground task, and then comes, demo background task. All right, and this is the reason why I have this service provider here. As a rule of thumb, or if you are not entirely sure, always resolve services from the service provider instead of constructor injecting them in background tasks. So you can do something like service provider get service, or even better, get required service, and inject the dependency here, like even an iContent manager or something like that. And now here we have a content manager. And from now on, you can use it exactly the same way as you would do with any constructor injected dependencies. So there is no difference there. Just remember not to constructor inject it, but use this service provider parameter here. And with this service provider is actually scoped, so a new context is created for every such DoWorkAsync execution, or at least once for every execution of all background tasks. In any case, you can be sure that this way the whole thing will work. But we won't really do anything here. We could do something like logging to make sure that it runs. But I will just make it easier since we are here in Visual Studio. We can just use the debugger to do a break and let's see it in the debugger that it actually has been executed. So I will do exactly that. Let's start the application now. And once the application starts, our background task will be automatically registered, and it will also be executed once that 1 minute passes. Actually, you can't use an execution period less than 1 minute. 1 minute is the minimum. And the reason for that is that, well, purchased internals have that 1 minute ping. So you can do 5 minutes or 2 weeks, but not less than 1 minute. All right, now let me go back to Visual Studio and let me attach the debugger to IIS Express here. And that means that immediately when this background task is executed, we will get a debugger break here, and we will see that it actually works. But while we are waiting for that, it will be 1 minute mouse. While we are waiting for that, let's check out something else here. And let's enable background tasks. And now this will actually restart the shell, restart the kind of the tenant. So that means that singleton dependencies at this point are actually re-registered, re-instantiated. But what is this background tasks feature? Well, it's a pretty cool one. Here now in the configuration, we have this new tasks menu. And under background tasks, we have a list of background tasks. So remember that I told you that you need to specify a description for a background task because it will be displayed on the admin? Well, this is exactly where it happens. Here we have an entry for our demo background task. And here is the corresponding description. You can also disable and enable background tasks. So, well, this is exactly for that. If you don't want the background task to run for whatever reason, you can disable it here explicitly. Usually, it's not a thing that you would do that by hand here, but you can also do that automatically. But in the meantime, our background task was hit. So, as you can see, we are back to the breakpoint. Pretty cool, it works. So let me continue the application. So usually you wouldn't disable or enable background tasks by hand. By off chance, that is also possible. But usually there is some other configuration which is better for that. Because for example, we see that the audit trail trimming task is running as well, and the timers for workflows. But in both cases, although you can disable the background task here, that's not necessary, because for audit trail, you can enable or disable trimming altogether. So here under audit trail settings, you can disable trimming. And then while the background task technically runs, it won't actually do anything. And again, the background task was hit, so it actually executes every minute. Let me deattach the debugger because we now trust that this actually works. And we also have the timer background task here, which is, again, not something that you would necessarily use because we have the corresponding feature, timer workflows activities here, that you can fully disable if you don't need workflow timers. Sometimes this can be useful. Usually, it's not an everyday thing that you disable or enable background tasks here. What's a bit more interesting, in my opinion, is that you can also enable and disable background tasks from code. So you can also create tasks that disable themselves. You can say that I want this task to run every minute until that date, or until it has completed everything, and then we won't need it at all until we explicitly enable it from the admin here or somehow else. So there are services for that in Orchard. You can check out in the source code of Orchard how this exactly works, because you know Orchard is open source. Everything is in there. If you open the solution and just search for pieces of text like even this text here, then you will see exactly where this UI is coming from, how it works, and how you can interact with it from code too. But for now, this was about background tasks, a little bit of introduction, but I hope you do see that writing such background tasks can be quite useful.